So in this video, we're going to go through the smooth bind options here and just show you a quick little example, really simplistic, and we'll do another example in a different video with something a bit more proper. But I just wanted to show how these different skinning methods respond to a very difficult situation, which is an overlapping yet open mesh. So we have our smooth bind options here. And of course, we have the first part, which is what to bind to. So the mesh will bind to either the joint hierarchy, which means it will, if I select one joint here, it's going to go to all of its friends, despite the fact that they're not actually selected. So we have that. And then we have selected joints, where if we want anything to be bound, we have to, of course, physically go ahead and select each one of them. There is a distinct benefit to this method in that if you go ahead and draw the way that I've drawn here, this guy is an actual deformer, and he doesn't really need to have any of these points assigned to him because he's not actually doing anything. He's basically been drawn in order to make sure that it's easy for me to select this and sort of visual clarity of the orientation of this joint. So a lot of times we do this and then we end up with stuff that doesn't need any weight values assigned to it. So by doing selected joints, we can basically eliminate those guys. Then we have object hierarchy, which is the same as joint hierarchy. Goes through the entire hierarchy, but it just includes objects. So we're going to go with joint hierarchy on this one. It's just a simple example. Then we have the bind method. Use the closest distance, which basically just reaches out within its drop-off radius and assigns stuff. That's basically it. Then we have closest hierarchy, which is very similar to closest in distance, except that it takes into consideration that, you know, this guy is assigned to this guy and he's also close to this one, so maybe it should be assigned to him. And they take some of those values in, but it still ends up, you know, getting caught up in these gaps here. Then we have heat map, which basically treats each one of these things kind of like a little heater, and it reaches out in a radius again with its own kind of heat map fall off, which is the same as drop off kind of idea, and it will reach out across the surface. It does a bit of a better job than the previous two, however, it does have a rather picky nature in that quite often if you have any problems at all with your mesh, and for instance, this really simplistic mesh that I've just created here, it doesn't like and actually will not bind to. So you can run into those kind of issues. And then we have the geodesic voxel, which is the one I'm most excited to show you because it can deal with the situation here. And basically it just builds voxels, which are sort of 3D pixels, and stacks them across the surface. And what we have with that is, of course, an actual resolution for finer detail if you desire. And then each one of these guys has their own little fall-off rate as well. It also has this validate voxel state. It's basically just a confirmation check just to make sure that it's actually, you know, done what it's supposed to do. In most cases, you can turn this off. You can turn it on if you want more verbose information about if you're getting a failure. But otherwise, it's just an extra check that doesn't need to be done, which means extra CPU cycles that you could probably save. Anyways, moving right along, skinning method. Classic linear, dual quaternion, or weight blended. So the classic linear is, of course, the cardboard tube sort of method of deformation, where when you collapse an elbow or a knee, it basically collapses in on itself. You basically lose volume in those areas. Whereas dual quaternion tends to do better volume preservation in those bend joints. So rather than the cardboard tube thing, you get more like a macaroni noodle kind of idea. Both of which you can, you know, do post-based deformation with set-driven key or something like that and make work even better, but it gives you at least a better starting point for that deformation. And then we have weight blended, where you can blend between them, and with that weight blended, actually, you can get some pretty nice deformation by going between the two of these things, where you're adding a little bit of volume with this, but then taking away a little bit of volume with this method. It allows you to just combine between the two of them. So it's pretty cool. Then we have our normalizations of the weights, which basically says in a 0 to 100%, or in this, this case, a 0 to 1 value, it basically makes sure that if I have a small value here and another small value here, that the two of them, when added together, if they're assigned to the same joint, will lead, or sorry, if the joints are assigned to the same vertex, will lead to a value of 1. So this vertex I'm assigned to you, and I'm assigned to you 50%, 40%, well, I'm missing 10%. So this guy will say, okay, well, then I'm going to redistribute that. I've got 10% left, so I'll give you 5, and I'll give you 5, and the ratio remains consistent. So that's what it tries to do. It will correct it to make sure that it's never leaving any values behind, which would, of course, then be set to the world and wouldn't be great. So interactive makes sure it's constantly doing that. As you paint, it's constantly updating and changing and altering that. Post means that it won't do it until basically, I think, that when the timeline goes. Post seems like the better option here, where you kind of like wait to the end, and once you've done everything, everything fixes. But it doesn't really work out that way. Often cases, it's rather confusing, and you really have to keep track of things. Otherwise, you end up with some bizarre ratios that you weren't expecting, and it can get kind of hairy. And then, of course, none at all, which is basically the same idea as post, except it never ever updates, and you have to manage it yourself. So, of course, primarily, a lot of people use interactive, and that's kind of the way that we go with it, which is why it's the default. And then we have weight distribution based on distance or neighbors. I want to go with neighbors. So just pure distance, it's not really considering what they're near to and what their neighbors' values are. We want to work with neighbors because it's a little bit more intelligent. It kind of pays attention to, you know, like, hey, buddy, who are you assigned to? Oh, well, I'm with joint one. Oh, okay, well, I'll go with joint one too. So it pays attention to that kind of stuff. And when you get around to smoothing, you should get a slightly better result. Amount of influences that you assign to. Often cases, a lot of people in Softimage will, at least in my experience, would drop this down to 2. And then, of course, in Maya, I drop it down to 2 as well. And it basically will assign just to 2 joints any individual vertex. And that makes it easier to manage in the initial setup stage. So when you're first, you know, preparing to do your weighting, you're not dealing with, you know, removing from a lot of different bones really small values. You're kind of dealing with just the 2. And then if you need to add more, you can go ahead and do that. Now, the next one here, maintain max influences, basically says it can only ever be assigned to 2. And maybe we don't want that. We want to start off with 2, and then if we decide we need more, then we go with it. And so that's what I can do. And of course, if you wanted to start with a more rigid bind, you can set that to 1. That would do a rigid bind, and then you can go and use smoothing with this thing on. It would start blending between them, so you could do that as well. Remove unused influences. This means some poor guy was left out of the kind of drop-off range, and he really wasn't included in the party. And so what happens is he no longer shows up in your weight panel when you go and do weighting. Even though he was selected during the bind, he basically is not invited. So if you turn this off, then it will make sure that he can receive some kind of, you know, skin bind painting at a later point. And if you need that, then of course you're going to want to make sure that that's set. Colorized skeleton, of course, all you guys used to using Softimage will love this, because this is basically what you're used to, multiple colors, and this leads to display of the bone color to the actual color of the vertices, so that you can have multicolor weight painting. Then we have include hidden selections on creation. This one is basically about geometry. If you have geometry that is currently hidden at the time of bind, it will ignore it. And if you tell it to include it, of course, even if it's hidden, it will go ahead and include it in that bind. So I've already bitching these guys. That's going to be great. So here's my quick example. Just another note, you'll notice that these guys are turning purple here as opposed to green, which is what will be yours. I've actually just been mucking around with some of my settings just from my child highlighting, I will show you just quickly, which is under selection, and then we have use object highlighting selection, or never highlight, or always highlight, which is the default. I think the default probably should be this, because you can define that on the actual object. So each object will have its own child selection highlighting rules that are there. But if you don't like the child selection highlighting at all, you can go ahead and just turn it off and nothing will ever highlight, except for in this case where it shows you relationships, where these guys all have relationships to each other and therefore they turn purple. So constraints and stuff like that will do this. So let's do this. We'll grab the joint. We've got joint hierarchy on, so it's going to automatically do all of them for me. And I've got the mesh, and I'm going to go ahead and bind skin. And lo and behold, I get this. Now, you see there's a little bit of some overlap issues here, which is easy enough to resolve. But if I go back to my rigging again and go back to my smooth bind, and instead of this, I'll go with closest in hierarchy, which is the common one prior to this mode, and bind this, you will see there is a lot more actual problem going on here. Let's just do wireframe unshaded here, and you can see that it's grabbed all of them across that lane there and is dragging them across no matter what. So the geodesic voxel one, pretty nice. Of course, just for sake of argument, we will do the heat map as well, and you can see the error that it gives me. Heat map, bind skin, and it says that I have a triangle with an area less than, and then it gives me this weird fucky value. And basically the idea is that it thinks that some object in here is really small, and that could be the scale of my object, which is just the default scale of the grid when you create it. I just quickly created one of those. So it doesn't like it. So I think it's expecting larger scale objects, and thus these points in here. So that's basically it. Those are your skin bind methods, and in the next video I will show you some weight painting and techniques on dealing with point associations on an actual model as opposed to one of these things.